Nick for the invite. It is such a pleasure to be here, and congratulations to everybody involved in this year's expo. It is great to see such an inspiring range of work across undergraduate, postgraduate, and doctoral programmes. As Nick mentioned, I run the Town and Country Planning Association, and I thought in launching this year's expo, I'd set out five reflections from running Britain's oldest housing and planning charity. Firstly, I want to start by doing a sales pitch for planning. Planning has been good for Britain. Well, planning often gets the blame for so much, and sometimes I think we get compared to traffic wardens in our popularity. We actually have so much to thank the pioneers of the planning movement for. They've done so much to shape this nation for the better. It's worth remembering that since the end of the 19th century, planning has improved the quality of life for millions of people in this country. It's delivered decent social housing, thanks to campaigns by the TCPA and research, analysis, policy and practice from leading universities like the Bartlett School of Planning. Planning has protected our countryside and our most valued landscapes from piecemeal development and urban sprawl that characterises so many other countries, so many parts of the USA and Europe. Planning, at its best, has promoted a mix of housing types and tenures and has resisted the extreme social segregation that results from gated communities. But planning in England is in a pretty tough place. Poorly resourced, deregulated, and a bit demoralised. Let's be honest, we've been delivering some pretty crap places. Now, that's not because of planning, it's down to a lack of planning. What we need is more planning, and the Bartlett has a really important role to play in putting planning back on track. It remains clear that the government is very serious about getting more homes built. And we support that, but if policies might not incentivise councils or ensure the delivery of affordable, well-designed homes in the right locations, then surely we all have a responsibility to help inform government policy and come up with constructive solutions. The challenge for all of us, but especially you, the next generation of planners, is to have the courage and the determination to leave future generations with a legacy of beauty and durability that truly meets the challenges of the 21st century. My second reflection, and sorry if this is all a bit doom and gloom, it gets more upbeat later on, but it feels a bit like we're losing control of the built environment. Let's be upfront about the dilemma we now face in England. There's no longer a national or regional way of solving our problems such as housing needs and regeneration. Relaxing committed development has led to tens of thousands of new homes being created without having to get full planning permission. For example, through the conversion of offices into flats. Now, we're not against the change of use, but doing this through committed development means that little or no thought is given to the most basic issues, such as where children can play or whether there's going to be enough doctor surgeries in the area. We're also seeing more and more development being approved in piecemeal locations, often through appeals, and that's leading to development that's often poorly served by infrastructure such as roads, hospitals, or schools. We're producing fewer and fewer affordable and social homes, so homelessness and affordability are blighting people's lives. And a government's building standards regime means that there's no national minimum space or accessibility standards for new homes. Room sizes are now the smallest in Europe. In some cases, they're so small, you can't even fit basic furniture into them. Now, each one of these things on its own might not have much impact, but taken together, we risk creating a legacy of poorly serviced, badly designed places that don't provide for those in greatest housing need. We can and should do so much better than this, And part of the solution is regaining control over the built environment. And there is so much in this room on display that can help do this. My third reflection, and you wouldn't be surprised coming from the TCPA that I'm going to say this, is that the case for a new generation of new towns and garden cities is a no-brainer. Yes, we made mistakes with the Garden Cities and the New Towns programme, but what an extraordinary contribution to Britain and the world. Britain's new towns are home to over 2.8 million people today. Over the past 8 years, the TCPA has created a huge amount of new interest in garden cities across the sector, and we have real political traction. However, it's really important that garden cities are far more than just a political buzzword or a branding exercise for development. I'm often amazed by how many people, particularly those in the built environment sector, argue against new towns because they think it detracts from urban regeneration. Given the scale of the housing crisis, I find this such a daft argument. Clearly, we need a whole portfolio of solutions, and that means regeneration alongside new communities. It's about ensuring the right development happens in the right place. I've also learned that the words garden cities, new towns, and the TCPA go hand in hand. We have a really outstanding history of the TCPA, of smart-looking men, often with a moustache and a pocket watch, pointing at a map and going, a new town should go here, here, and here. Things are slightly different these days. But these people, starting with Ebenezer Howard and Frederick J. Osborne, through to Sir Peter Hall, who we loved so much and missed dearly, all shared a belief in creating great places at scale and an understanding that land values need to be shared in order to achieve this. Now, while we may not share the same dress sense or facial hair as the early Garden City and Newtown pioneers, we do share the beliefs today that planning is about combining utopian ideals and environmental protection with a radical idea about redistributing resources for the benefit of everyone in society. Thinking about the pioneers brings me on to my fourth reflection about planning and placemaking, which is, where are all the women? Now, there are many women in this room, and we have made tons of progress, particularly in our planning schools, but we still have such a long way to go to make the sector representative. The RTPI has the biggest female membership of the built environment professional bodies. They're currently on 37%. I was looking at the RIBA's figures today, and 48% of their 12,500 student members are women. That's great, almost gender parity. But when you look at their chartered members, of which there's over 22,000, that number drops down to 20%. And when we look at the RICS's membership in the UK, just 14% are women. Now, addressing inequality in the built environment is so important to addressing spatial inequalities in our communities. And of course, this isn't just about gender. It's also about attracting people from different ethnic backgrounds and those from disadvantaged backgrounds. And the Bartlett can play a really positive role in helping address this balance and encouraging people to go out and pursue their careers having studied here. My fifth, and you'll be relieved to know, final reflection, is that planning has to reconnect with people. No one loves an acronym as much as a planner. Have you ever sat through a lecture or a meeting and counted the acronyms? I'm sure you haven't because you're all far too studious and far too professional. But we do love an MPPF, an MPPG, an MPS, an SPG, an SEA, an EIA, a PPA. Anyhow, you get the idea. But for anybody outside of planning, we may as well be speaking Swahili. This always hits home when I'm out and about with the TCPA. In fact, very occasionally, running the TCPA is a little bit like being in a band and going on tour. Some of you may know that we produced an album which we like to describe as the Desert Island Discs of the planning movement. We've done this to try and communicate planning in a different way, and it's been loads of fun. from performing at Hay Festival, where a Waitrose crowd turned up en masse to discuss their neighbourhood's plans for a conservatory, to performing in a field at a folk festival in rural Derbyshire, where the locals told us to F off back to London and take High Speed 2 with us. On this journey of music, meetings, research, site visits, and never-ending planning reform, I have met so many inspiring people, but also so many people who've been derogatory about planning and planners. I've met developers who think that planning is solely there to help meet their needs to make a profit. I've met celebrated architects who think they're the bee's knees. And I've met many regeneration professionals who think they're the go-getters. And what strikes me is that planning really needs to regain its cool. Good development, good architecture, good regeneration all need good planning and great planners. So, to everybody here at this wonderful Bartlett School of Planning Expo, for those of you who've got a glass, I'd like you to raise it and join me in making a toast to being great planners.